imagine your life as a long branch of a tree. And along that branch, there are smaller branches that pop up, or little buds along the way. And each one of those is a story that comprises the greater story that you tell yourself about who you are.
I'd like to welcome to the show, Rich Rollman. How you doing, Rich?
Good, 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 man. Happy to be here. Excited to talk to you, Alex. Thanks for having me.
Man, thank you so much for coming on the show, my friend. I've been an admirer of yours for a while from a distance, being a vegan and a plant-based person myself, and you are in many ways a source of inspiration for us old folks. You know what I mean?
Come on, man. I'm older than you. I'm sure I'm older than you.
You are a few years older than me, without question. But but your beginning of your journey in your 40s, that you changed your whole life and became this athlete, and I'm in my 40s knocking on the door of 50, and I'm like, well, there's hope for us. So I can't wait to get into the conversation with you, man. So the first question I wanted to ask you, Rich, is, before your transformation, what was life like before you became this kind of fitness guru and changed your whole life and everything?
Yeah, I mean, I grew up in a pretty traditional household. My needs were met. I was reared in the Washington, D.C. area, and grew up in a pretty education-first environment with pretty high expectations for achievement. I was kind of an awkward, socially anxious kid who had a hard time figuring out how to fit in. I definitely wasn't one of the cool kids, and found swimming. That was my kind of first love and sport that served me well. It was the one thing that I actually had any competence in, and I learned about life and how to accomplish goals through that sport that transferred into the classroom. And so by the time I was a senior in high school, I was pretty accomplished in both of those arenas and got into a bunch of fancy colleges, ended up going out to the West Coast, to Stanford, to attend this amazing university, but also to compete on their swim team, which at the time was like the number one program in the country. And it was like a dream come true. I was training with like Olympic champions and world record holders and stuff like that, albeit me being kind of a bench warmer. I wasn't a scholarship athlete, and lived that life and loved it. But when swimming was over, that was kind of the end of my athletic career. And, that vacuum ended up getting filled with drugs and alcohol, which, took me down some dark alleyways. I have a whole kind of addiction recovery story. Mm-hmm. That got pretty dark and really upended my life in some pretty serious ways. But I had the good fortune of getting sober at 31 after attending law school and kind of pursuing a career in law, and spent between 31 and 40 really building a foundation of sobriety and beginning to kind of wrestle with my inner demons and, why I had, behaved that way, and started asking myself deeper questions about, who I wanted to be in the world. And it became apparently, kind of evident that I was in the wrong career. Like, I kind of pursued this career in law because I just felt like it was what was expected of someone like me, and not really a function of what I was naturally kind of attracted to. I was sort of jamming a square peg into a round hole. And because I know how to work hard, I know how to suffer and all of that, was able to achieve some modicum of success. But I always felt like I was living somebody else's life. And with the tools that I was learning in sobriety, it was slowly becoming untenable to have this kind of, multiple personality or kind of, split between this, person that I was slowly becoming and the person who kind of showed up in the professional world. And that ended up kind of creating a bit of an existential crisis that collided with a health scare, because ever since I retired from swimming, I never really took care of myself. And in the kind of corporate law context, it's all about, 80-hour weeks and ordering in takeout food and hitting the fast food drive-through on the way home. And I put on 50 pounds, and you know, that all caught up to me in a pretty visceral singular moment where I struggled to walk up a simple flight of stairs without getting winded and had tightness in my chest and heart disease runs in my family. And it was sort of like that moment when I decided I needed to get sober. But in this case, I realized I needed like rehab for my life, or rehab at least initially for how I was taking care of myself. And that kind of set in motion a series of events that have, you know, over many, many years led me to what I'm doing today. But, you know, I ended up changing my relationship with food and with my body and adopted a plant-based diet and invigorated from that, you know, started pursuing athletic interests. And that led me into the world of ultra endurance. And in my 40s, was able to distinguish myself in some, you know, kind of interesting races that caught the attention of the media because people were confused. Now there's lots of plant-based athletes, but at the time there weren't very many out there and people wanted to know, like, how do you go and do, you know, a 3-day double Ironman race when you're not eating any animal products and not for nothing? Like, aren't you like a lawyer? Like, what are you even doing here to begin with? Oh, you know, that like opened up a lot of doors for me and led to the opportunity to write a book and the podcast I started in the wake of the book coming out. And like, here we are today and I get to talk to cool people like you.
Oh, well, thank you for that. And it's really interesting. What I find fascinating about your story is by that once you got sober, there was almost a decade time period there where from the outside, it seemed like you had everything. You were successful. You were, you know, making money. You were, you know, living the dream, as many people think. You worked as a corporate, if I'm not mistaken, as a lawyer in Hollywood in one way, shape, or form, in the entertainment business.
Yeah, in Century City. Yeah.
Right. So then you're hanging out with celebrities and those. So from the outside, you know what I mean. Kind of. You know, you're not hanging out. You're not at Brad Pitt's house. I get it. But generally speaking, from the outside, a lot of people looking at it like, oh man, you work in Hollywood and you work in entertainment law and all that. So it seemed like you had everything, but there was something missing on the inside. And I'm sure you know many of your colleagues who are still there and didn't have that kind of, you know, for lack of a better term, come to Jesus moment where they just said, I have to change something inside of me. What was that thing inside you that was calling for you to make this change? What was making you so unhappy? What was that thing inside you that you said, besides the health scare on this kind of thing, this crisis that you had?
Yeah, I mean, it was really pain. You know, pain is the only thing that's ever gotten me to, like, you know, make hard decisions or take risks or change, you know, any of my errant ways. And, you know, the facts of my experience are unique to me, but I think it's pretty common that, you know, people wake up after many years in a chosen career and think, like, is this, like, wait, I wasn't sure this was the life that I actually consciously chose for myself. And I certainly was one of those people, but it just became harder and harder to show up and even do simple tasks in my job. Like, I just knew, like, I'm not supposed to be here. And yet I had invested so much time and so much money in this career and was kind of raised in a safety-seeking household. Like, I don't come from a long line of entrepreneurs and risk takers or artists. Like, you get your good job and you work hard and you put your nose down and that's how you make your way in the world. So the idea of like walking away from this career was the most terrifying thing I could possibly imagine. And, you know, just to disabuse people who might have some familiarity with my story of like how it all went down, it wasn't some big dramatic thing. It was a very gradual process of starting to attune my focus and my attention into things that were bringing me joy and happiness and kind of fertilizing that terrain over many, many years while I was slowly kind of losing interest in the law and investing in other things. You know, it took a long time. Like, I left the corporate law firm, but then I was a solo practitioner and then I practiced law with like a couple partners and went back to being but all the while kind of like losing interest and making less and less money doing it because I was diverting that, you know, my attention into other places that weren't paying the bills. And now everything's fine. But you know, I had to endure some hardship making that transition, some financial hardship in order to make it work.
So it sounds like you did an inventory of your life. Do you have any tips for people who are listening that might be in that same place where they're just not happy where they are? They might be financially stable or in that way, but not happy. I remember I had a job that was paying me, I was one of the highest paid editors doing promos in Florida in the early 2000s or in late 90s, I think. But I was miserable because I was doing promos for Matlock, for God's sakes. But I was making insane money, and I literally just started to act up so I could get fired. I literally, on a subconscious level, started to do things that made me impossible to work with because I just wanted to get out. And I didn't have the courage to do what you did, even if it was a slow process. I didn't even have that courage. So how do you, any tips you have as far as doing inventory, a life inventory of where you are?
Yeah, sure. I mean, I'll preface my answer by saying that, you know, especially in our social media age, we're kind of inundated with these messages of like, pursue your passion and like, you should chase your dream and all of that. And I think, although, you know, that comes from a good place, you know, everybody should feel fulfilled in the life that they're pursuing. I think oftentimes it makes people feel bad about themselves because a lot of people actually don't know what their passion is or what the thing would be that would make them happy. And so it ultimately, you know, becomes like a guilt-inducing thing. And I was certainly one of those people. Like, I never even considered what might make me happy or what could be a different possibility for how I was living. And the only, you know, so the advice that I would give is just to share the experience of what I did. This isn't the only way. But it began with some of the tools that I learned in 12 steps through recovery. And that tends to be kind of the lens through which I, you know, process all of these things. And a big part of that is doing an inventory, like a big inventory and then a daily inventory that kind of connects you more objectively to your behaviors. And over time kind of reveals patterns and you start to see, why do I keep doing this thing? And it just makes you more reflective and creates a greater understanding of what's impulsing you and you know, and the like. And then beyond that, and I will credit our mutual friend, Sasha, for getting me involved in this, but I started doing The Artist's Way, which is Julia Cameron's book and program that is really about unlocking creativity. I'm sure, you know, the many screenwriters that are fans of yours are familiar with this. It's a great program for anybody who wants to be a writer. But I think beyond that, it's an incredible tool for that journey of like self-connection and trying to, you know, figure out what your authentic voice is. And, you know, a big piece in that is doing what's called the morning pages, which is just writing 3 pages the first thing in the morning, which is kind of like a, you know, the garbage dump of like getting out of your head, like all the stuff that you ruminate on, so that you can kind of get clear on what it is that you really want to focus on. And that's been a practice that, you know, I've been doing for decades at this point. And then to supplement that, there's a book called The War of Art by Stephen Pressfield. I'm sure you're familiar with that. Sasha was the first person to give me a copy of that book. And that's a book that I read. I read that book, you know, at least once a year, and I've had Stephen Pressfield on my podcast. I just have so much reverence and respect for that book and the other books on that terrain, that subject matter that he's written. And that was also super helpful. And then just beyond that, like just the practice of journaling every day, you know, as a means of developing that connection, you start to learn about yourself. And I remember very vividly making a decision, not about like, oh, I'm going to leave this career in an explosion of glory and go do something else. It was really a journey of like, well, what does make me happy? Like, I wasn't even sure, right? So, oh, you know what? Like, I really miss swimming. Like, I'm going to go back to the pool. Or I really like, you know, kind of running outdoors with my shirt off with the sun on my back. Like, it wasn't, I need this car, or I need this position, or I need this house or apartment. It was really primal, simple things. And I just, you know, decided that I was going to give myself permission to indulge in those pursuits that made me happy. And I wasn't going to make them subservient to some career path. And sometimes the more you do the things that bring you joy, maybe it's like model airplane building or, right, you know, writing jokes for possibly becoming a stand-up comedian or whatever it is in your life. I think when you water that garden, you're giving it energy and you're kind of telling the universe, hey, this is what I'm into. And in my experience, the universe kind of responds in kind by saying, oh, you're into that? Like, well, here's a little Easter egg. Like, why don't you come over here? Like, it's not like a whole path gets laid out in front of you, like where you could see clearly how this might become a career, but you start to get evidence in the form of little openings and kind of cracks in the universe that continue to guide you. And I made a choice of following those, you know, little bricks as they got laid in front of me, and did not have any idea how that would ever become a vocation. But I kind of put that out of my mind. And I said, I don't care. Like, I like doing these things, and I'm going to continue to do them. And I trust that, you know, in the process of doing this, I'm finding something out about myself. I'm figuring out who the authentic, you know, person is inside of me and trying to bring voice to that. And I think when you develop that as a practice, it becomes kind of a guiding force or principle that leads you in a direction in which opportunities will eventually arise. Maybe not on your timeline or never, in the manner in which you desire. Yeah, like it doesn't work out like when you imagine what it could be like. It doesn't work like that. But if you're devoted to the process of it, to the practice of it, it almost doesn't matter, because those opportunities are like side benefits. The real juice is like the sense of self that you get from committing to, you know, that type of way of life.
It's so interesting, and I think you can agree with me on this. When I started podcasting, I was like, this is where the money is, obviously. My first episode, I'm like, oh yeah, I'm gonna be doing this for the next 7 years, and it's gonna support my family. Like, that was not a thing that was even in my mind. I wished it, I hoped for it, and it was my side hustle for a little while I was still directing and doing post-production and things like that. But I started to feed it little by little, more and more, and all of a sudden people started to show up. And with this show, which is a much newer show, it's only about a little bit over a year old, all of a sudden, you know, I get calls and I'm like, hey, do you want, you know, I know Rich. Do you think Rich would be a good guest? I'm like, yeah, I think Rich would be a fantastic guest to come on the show. And things, so the universe starts to open up and provide opportunities when you give it signals that you are serious about something. Mm-hmm. Is that your experience as well?
Yeah, 100%. 100%. Yeah. And, you know, my experience with my podcast is not dissimilar. I mean, I started it 10 years ago. So the idea that it could be a vocation or you could make a living doing it was preposterous. I mean, you know, even Adam Carolla at that time, you know, was trying to figure out how to make money doing it. Like, nobody was making, you know. So I was doing it for the joy and for the love, and because it was fulfilling, and, you know, the ecosystem kind of grew up around me while it was happening, and I found myself in a very privileged situation all of a sudden. But it wasn't because that was a strategy or a plan. It was because it was an extrapolation of that very same practice, which is like, this is enjoyable for me and it's fulfilling and I dig it and it's making my life better. And, you know, I'm going to keep doing this and just see where it leads me. And it really was nothing more than
that. And also that we're also serving others as well. I think that was the big takeaway for me, is that by me doing this, I serve other people, and that feels really good. And helping other people with these conversations and guiding them through pitfalls of the film industry and now here in the spiritual and personal growth space, you know, this conversation is going to help somebody listening to it or someone watching it around the world. And we have no idea the impact that our actions have on other people, especially people like us, like doing podcasting or writers or things. You have no idea what your art or your work will, how it will affect other people. Because I'm sure you've had this. People probably come up to you at events and go, Rich, man, your podcast has changed my life. Oh my God. It's like, it's happened to me. And it's such a oh my God, such an amazing feeling when you hear something like that.
Yeah, it is very cool and very fulfilling and almost embarrassing. But
yeah, agreed.
when you can like wed something that you enjoy to a purpose that is greater than yourself, I mean, that's the real juice. And, you know, the service thing is something, again, that I learned in recovery. Like, prior to getting sober, the idea that you could enhance the fulfillment and happiness and sense of purpose in your own life by, like, giving of yourself to other people selflessly, like, that was not part of my mental model at all. But I've learned to do that reflexively, and it's a practice because I'm selfish and irascible and, you know, grumpy and all the like, just like anybody else. But when I cultivate that, my life gets better. And what's really cool is that it's helpful to other people. And I just don't know what else in life is, you know, cooler than that, honestly.
Now, there's a lot of things that we do in our lives, in regards to the stories that we tell ourselves. And the stories that we tell ourselves are the things that hold us back for the most part. How do you get past those stories? Because, I mean, you went through some, you know, some tough times with addiction, and that story haunts people and can completely ruin people's lives if you continue to tell that story and live in that story and not focus on the future. How do you, or what advice do you have for people listening to get past those stories that we tell ourselves, that we can't do this or we can't do that? Oh my God, that happened to me, so that's why I can't go there. I'm not worth it. So on and so forth.
Yeah. I mean, I think that's a great question. I think this is like an epidemic. Most people are stuck in some kind of narrative loop, whether positive or negative. It doesn't matter because it's not true. You know, like, most of what we tell ourselves about ourselves and the world and our past and what we're capable of, you know, is a lie. So I think the first step is to recognize that and develop like a separation between your higher consciousness and the kind of, vacillations of your thinking mind, right? So it's like, it's a kind of developing a more Eastern perspective, like, oh, actually, I can be an observer of my thoughts, and those thoughts don't have to control me. I think, you know, like, that epiphany for me was huge, to realize, like, oh, I have an awareness of what my mind is thinking. Those things aren't necessarily the same. You know what I'm saying? Like, that was huge. Mm-hmm. And then understand that you do have the power to change your story, and that your story is really, in essence, just a few isolated incidents. Like, imagine your life as a long branch of a tree, and along that branch, there are smaller branches that pop up, or little buds along the way. And each one of those is a story that comprises the greater story that you tell yourself about who you are. But in truth, that branch is long, and there's millions, if not billions, of other stories that just never sprouted into branches for some reason. Mm-hmm. But we, in our minds, drill down on a couple few examples and decide, this is how I will be defined, or how I'm defining myself. And I think to broaden your attention and say, why am I giving that story so much attention when this other thing over here, which contradicts that story that I believe to be true, puts into question the whole story that I'm telling myself about who I am, suddenly you feel empowered to kind of shift that narrative. And I think the other thing is learning how to be honest with yourself, especially about your secrets and the things that you're hiding or that you're ashamed of or grief-stricken about, and trying to bring voice to those, because a lot of our negative self-talk derives from some form of shame about something that happened to us or something that we did. And unless we, you know, excavate that through therapy, through sharing with another human being, or any other kind of, you know, modality that suits you, it will continue to fester and kind of entrench that negative story that you're looking to transcend. So I'm a huge believer in therapy, and obviously in recovery and all these other modalities that have allowed me to make peace with my past, so that it doesn't it doesn't imprison me anymore. And, you know, I can tell you from somebody who's been to thousands and thousands of AA meetings, there's nothing more extraordinary or liberating than seeing somebody get up in front of a group of people and tell some harrowing story about some shameful thing that happened to them or that they did, and do it without any kind of like emotional trigger attached to it.
Right.
Because you see somebody who's made peace with that and it doesn't hold them hostage. You're like, wow, like that guy did that and he's like laughing about it. Like, how do you do that? And you do it through summoning the courage to be vulnerable. And, you know, we're taught, especially, you know, as men, that vulnerability is a weakness.
Right.
And I think it requires a tremendous amount of courage to be vulnerable because you're being asked to talk about things that you're ashamed about. But in that sharing and in that, you know, flexing of vulnerability, that's where you find true strength and peace with yourself. And I think that's the real engine that will lead you to, you know, changing your story and creating a healthier one.
Now, during your recovery and then also during the time that you were moving towards becoming more of an athlete, what part did spirituality play in that? Did you connect to, you know, not religious, but did you connect to other things that were higher than yourself, internal meditation, Eastern philosophies? What part did any of that play in this transformation that you, this massive transformation from where you were to where you are today?
Yeah, I mean, for me, it's all spiritual. And that spirituality has never taken any kind of dogmatic form. And it's been, you know, a kind of a slow expanding experience for me. You know, I grew up in a, like I said, a pretty traditional house. We went to church once in a while, but yeah, I never connected with that in any meaningful way and had no interest in investing any of my energy in anything religious or spiritual. And it wasn't until I was kind of utterly broken and in a treatment center where it was impressed upon me that, you know, my best thinking, me thinking I'm this smart guy and I have these fancy degrees and I've done this and I've done that. Well, my best thinking basically landed me in a mental institution. I mean, that's what a treatment center is, right? Like, how smart are you, dude?
So, that's amazing. By the way, I got to stop you. I got to stop you there for a second. That is an amazing comment. Do you like, you're so fancy. You've got all this stuff. Look where all of this intelligence has landed you. Great. I just wanted to point that out. It's amazing.
Yeah, that was, you know, the ego doesn't want to hear that, but that's exactly what the ego needed to hear, right?
Right.
So, you know, you think you've got it all figured out in your mind, but if you can let go of your attachment to how your brain functions and allow other people in to guide you, people who know a little bit more about this world than you, if you can humble yourself, you just might learn a thing or two. And, you know, I got sober because a guy handed me a broom and said, sweep the floor. And instead of saying, how is that going to keep me from drinking? I just said, okay, I'll do it. And when somebody said, well, why don't you make the coffee, you know, at this meeting at 6 o'clock in the morning every day, I just said, okay, I'll do that because these people seem to have figured out how to stay sober. Whereas my mind would say, I don't need to do that. Just tell me how to like not drink. Like, I don't want to make coffee for anybody. So it was, you know, I think humbling myself into a place of realizing like I don't have all the answers and I can't solve this in my mind was a huge piece. And I remember in that treatment center, one of the counselors saying to me, Rich, are you a spiritual being having a human experience or a human being, or what did he say? Are you a human being having a spiritual experience or a spiritual being having a human experience? And I was like, wait, say that again? And like, I still can't get it right. And I was like, I don't understand the question. Like, I was so detached from, you know, being able to really kind of understand anything non-material at the time, but I've since come to truly believe that, you know, I'm a spiritual being having a human experience. And, you know, we tend to believe that our senses, what we can see, hear, smell, taste, feel, is the ultimate dictate of reality, but I think there's a lot more going on. And when you live in the mystical and you live in the awe and the wonder and you open yourself up for greater possibilities, that's when I think that the true magic can occur. And yeah, so me, again, that's another practice that when I can inhabit that, then I'm available for the miracle. And when I look back over the last 15 years, the fact that I'm in the position that I'm in right now, it makes absolutely no sense. There's no logical or rational explanation for how I went from where I was to where I am today. Like, this is not the result of, you know, my self-will or, you know, my plan or some goal that I was, you know, seeking. There's a lot more at play here, I think, you know, I'd like to believe. And so that's kind of, you know, it is a more Eastern, obviously, you know, perspective on reality. But again, it doesn't, and it leans towards, you know, Buddhist traditions and et cetera, but I wouldn't consider myself a Buddhist.
You know, one of the questions when we decided to do this conversation together, the one question that kept popping into my head, I'm like, I have to ask Rich this question because it's a question that so many of us have trouble with, especially when we're doing something large. How did you tell yourself the story that you were going to become an ultra athlete in your 40s? Like, there must have been a thought process, and I'm sure your brain said, you're insane. As by the way, many other voices around you said the same thing. If I may quote your book, people were like, you're absolutely nuts. And now you're not only going to just run a little marathon or half marathon, you're talking about an Ironman and then eventually an ultra marathon, double Ironman. What was the thought process that made you believe that you could even attempt to step on the same field with people that have been doing this for years and also younger athletes than yourself?
The only way I know how to answer that is that there was something inside of me that like I can only characterize as a knowing, you know, like I just knew that it felt right. And there was like an internal switch that got flicked and a sense of direction. Like it just felt like I just knew this was what I needed to do. And I knew that I was capable of doing it. Like, and I very vividly, there was a couple of events leading up to that. I mean,
sure.
You know, I was getting more fit, and I talk about this in the book. I went out for a run. I had only been running, you know, a little bit at that point, and ended up like running like 24 miles, which is longer than I ever had. And I felt amazing. And I thought like, wow, like I never thought that was something that I could do. Like maybe I'm sitting on, you know, some kind of untapped potential that I wasn't aware of. And I started getting interested in the world of ultra endurance, which was something I had no familiarity with whatsoever. And I think it was compounded by the fact that, you know, alcoholism really, crushed my athletic dreams in college. Like I had not achieved my potential as an athlete. So there was a bit of unfinished business there. But I read about this Ultraman race, which for people that don't know is a double Ironman distance triathlon that over 3 days circumnavigates the entire Big Island. It's like a 320-mile race. And in this article, the description of this experience made it sound more like a story out of the Bhagavad Gita. Like it was like this spiritual odyssey. It wasn't like a race. It was, yes, it's a race, it's a world championship, and like people are trying to win, but it really was about transformation. And it spoke to me because I realized that was what I was seeking. Like I was trying to pursue personal transformation through endurance. And it was like this epiphany where I realized that like endurance training is like this catalyst or this vehicle for greater self-understanding. Like when you test yourself, when you take your body to the ultimate limits and mentally, emotionally, and physically, et cetera, it's sort of like, sitting in the cave for 90 days, you know, it's a version of that where suddenly you can't run from yourself and you meet yourself as you really are. And with that experience, you deepen your understanding of self. And really for me, like, yes, I'm an athlete, but it's really about ultra endurance as this vehicle for spiritual growth. And here it was like, here's this race. It's everything that you're looking for. And something inside of me, even though that sounded insane and I couldn't believe human beings could even, you know, propel themselves for these distances, I was like, that is what I'm looking for. That is what I'm going to do. Like, this is going to happen. And I kind of started to orient my life around pursuing that goal.
It's a remarkable story. I've heard that athletes, when they are, especially athletes at the level that you were competing in, you're pushing your body and your mind to places that human beings generally don't go, and that at a certain point, and please let me know what, correct me if I'm wrong, but at a certain point, you don't think anymore, and you're now just, you're just being. And there's that thing called the flow, or the flow state. During those moments when you're on that, like the last leg, I guess, or wherever in that race, it got to a point where everything in your body is saying stop, but yet you mm-hmm. keep going. I remember I've heard David Goggins talk about this a lot on his interviews, that you just keep going. Is there something that you tap into? Is it almost a spiritual place that you go to? Because you transcend where you are at a certain point. In my small ability, in small times doing athletic competitions, I've had that in small doses. I can only imagine at the level that you were competing in. So what happens at that moment? And do you have a spiritual, did you ever have a spiritual like thing happen to you? I mean, I'm not saying that Jesus is running next to you or something, but something that you tap into, that flow state, that thing that it's hard to explain with words.
Yeah, I mean, it is hard to explain with words, and I'm not sure that I can really, you know, put words to it, other than to say that there is an aspect of flow state, but it's a little bit different. Like flow state, it's flow state-esque in that your relationship with time kind of shifts, and there is a sense of oneness, but because it's so painful, it's not pleasurable in the way that flow states are typically characterized. So I think it's a little bit different, but you know, it has kind of shared DNA with like what it must be like to have a breakthrough in meditation, where, you know, your consciousness feels expanded and there is a oneness between your mind, body, your soul, and the environment that you're in that is inexplicable. And I think it's what a lot of endurance athletes are chasing, because in that heightened state, there's no room for that thinking mind to like loop, you know, because you're basically in this survival mode. And what's exciting about that is really testing the outer limits of what you're capable of. And the fulfilling aspect of it is realizing that you can do more than you think, than you thought that you could. And I think we're all, you know, capable of that. And, you know, these endurance races are just a vehicle for connecting with that. And those experiences then raise the ceiling on how you see the world more broadly. And you realize like, oh, what other areas of my life am I kind of just blithely, you know, bundling through, where, you know, I'm even unaware that I could be doing better or doing more. But in those moments, yeah, like, I don't know how else to describe it other than that. I mean, it sucks when you're in it. I don't want to make it sound like there's some kind of like ecstatic, like, you know, it's
some blissful place. Some blissful place.
You want your spot, you know, but it's like, even if you go one step further, it's like an esteemable act, right? And that builds upon itself. And so brick by brick, you're kind of creating this new person as a result of putting yourself on the line in that kind of visceral way.
Yeah, and you're just kind of like, I have to believe you're breaking down all preconceptions you might have had in your mind at one point or another while you're going through that process, especially the first time. If you do it after a few times, I mean, you've been there before, but that first time that you were going and you were pushing yourself beyond places you've ever gone physically, mentally, I gotta believe that. I mean, I have to believe that the monkey brain inside your head must have been going, 100 miles a minute, just going stop, stop, you're hurting yourself, you're going to kill yourself. How did you, I mean, we all have monkey brains and we have problems just on a daily basis. I can only imagine trying to shut out that voice when you are literally breaking your body down to a place where you are on the edge of a possibly really hurting yourself.
Well, I mean, two observations on that. I mean, the thing to understand is that it's not like you show up for this race and you haven't done anything similar to it. Like
right.
The training leading up to it, like this slow boil. It's like you see Laird Hamilton drop in on a 40-foot wave and it's, you know, he didn't go from a 1-foot wave to a 40-foot wave. Like he worked his way up to that so that the 40-foot wave is his new normal. And the training that was put in to do these races was, you know, analogous to that. I mean, there were breakthroughs. I remember, you know, I worked up to a point where I had to do a 40-mile run, you know, for in training, you know, for this race. And that was just, you know,
insane.
I'd never done any, yeah. And I did it, you know, and I started in Venice and I ran all the way up to Point Doom along PCH and then ran back.
Wow.
And I just couldn't believe that I actually succeeded in doing that. And I still had like, you know, I don't know, like two and a half, three months before the race. So it's like I had experiences along the way so that when I showed up at the race, like I knew I could do it already because I'd done so much of training. So it wasn't like, oh my God, I'm never going to be able to do that. Like I knew that I, as long as I didn't crash my bike or some, you know, unless something went terribly wrong, like that I was going to be able to complete the distance. It was just a question of like, you know, what's the strategy, you know, how to do it and all of that kind of stuff. So there's that. And then I think, yeah, you have this voice in your mind saying stop, stop, stop. But, you know, part of like being in that elevated heart rate where it's just your breath, you know, does quiet that. And it can be kind of a peaceful thing. Like you can't be going all out in a 3-day race. Like you've got to find a pace that's manageable and it becomes about efficiency and economy. Like, what is the pace that I can sustain for 9 hours on this bike or 8 hours on this bike, you know, and because you adequately train for it. Like you're like, okay, I know what that is and I know what that should feel like so that I can finish, you know, and not be like dying at the end because I've got to wake up the next day and run 52 miles for the third day of that race.
That's, yeah. I mean, it's, as we're talking, I'm thinking about like 40 miles. I'm like 40. I can't even run a mile, let alone 40 in a day as part of your training, no less. So it's all
perspective. I mean, there's right. actual runners now that are running 240 mile races and, you know, there's always somebody doing like something crazier. And that's what's, you know, amazing about the human spirit. Like once mm-hmm. somebody does something, then the floodgates open and then, you know, everybody can do that all of a sudden.
It's 4-minute mile, the 4-minute mile thing. Yeah.
So
there was a moment in your book that you talk about a crash that happened and how it kind of the challenge of crashing your bike and having to keep moving forward and the kind of analogy of life and what you have to do when certain things happen, because, you know, you're in the middle of a race. You're dying already. It's hard on you. You're physically beating down. And then all of a sudden, your bike crashes on you. And now you have to pick yourself up and keep going with this new challenge in front of you. Can you talk about what mentally you had to go through with that? It's just that there's one specifically in the book that you talk about.
Yeah. And I think what's interesting about that story is that it's not about the bike crash. It's kind of like what's applicable to everybody in their lives in terms of like meeting obstacles. I mean, in that case, it was, you know, the second time I'd done this race, Ultraman. It was on day two. The first day I had won the stage and I had like a 10-minute lead on everyone. And it looked like I could, you know, be on the podium at this race, which was absolutely insane because I was like 44 years old and had only been at this for a couple of years. And, you know, on this day two, which is 171 miles on the bike, about 30 miles in, I slipped on wet pavement and went down and crashed pretty hard, banged up my knee, took all the skin off my shoulder, and importantly, cracked my pedal, you know, off of my crank. So it wasn't just like get back on your bike and ride. Like I had no pedal, right? And it was an area of the race with this race, every competitor has a crew that follows them in like a minivan that feeds them and, you know, takes care of, make sure that they're safe and all of that. But this was like a protected area of the island where they didn't allow vehicles. So I had to pick myself back up and figure out like if I was okay and get on my bike and pedal on with one leg to, you know, like another mile or two to get to where all the crew vehicles were waiting for the athletes to pass this particular section. And in that, you know, period of time, I realized like, well, this is over for me. Like I'm not going to ride, you know, 140 miles with one leg. I mean, that's, you know, this is not happening. Like I'm done. And this sucks because I, you know, 10 minutes ago, I was in a very different mindset, thinking about podiums. And now suddenly another switch got flicked and I'm like, wow, I can like gracefully bow out of this really painful experience and nobody can give me a hard time because I don't have a pedal. Like, right. And I start thinking about going to the beach the next day with my kids and sleeping in the, you know, nice hotel room and all that kind of stuff. And that's what's going on in my mind. And when I meet up with my crew and these other crew vehicles, guy who was working for another athlete saw my bike and he's like, what kind of pedal do you need? And I looked at him, he was much bigger than me. I kind of looked up at him. I said, why are you asking me? Like, I'm done. And he disappeared and he came back and he had a box. And in that box was a brand new version of the exact pedal that I'd broken. And he grabbed my bike and he put the new pedal on. And he's like, here's your bike. Like, get back on it. Like, your wife is here and your kids are here. They didn't come all this way for you to like back out, you know, because you banged up your knee. And that was not what I wanted to hear. And I think what was, you know, really instructive about that experience is, you know, how powerful the mind is. Like 1 minute I'm like all in on this race and then something happens and suddenly I'm like, I'm done, I'm out, I've checked out. And then having to get back into that former mindset again, like is very, very difficult. And, you know, I did it and then I ended up, you know, completing that race and doing quite well. And what I learned from that really is that, you know, when things don't go your way, like ideally I would have liked to have, you know, been on the podium at that race, et cetera. And that the ego loves that and you get a lot of attention for that. But like, if everything goes to plan, like, what do you actually learn? Like, well, you learn that you can execute on a goal and that's valuable. But other than that, you don't learn a whole heck of a lot. But when something goes terribly wrong, and you're forced to make a choice, a decision, that decision and that choice are your teachers. Like those are what reveal character, right? And I realized in that moment that, you know, I was more capable than I thought that I was. And I learned more from, you know, things not going my way than I would have ordinarily. And it made me realize and remember that I didn't get into the sport to be on podiums. I got into it for the reasons I explained to you earlier, which was to have a transformative experience and to be faced with an obstacle, meet it and overcome it, was a big piece in that transformative journey that I was seeking. So it was great and I wouldn't change a thing. And ultimately, you know, it's something that I still think about to this day when things don't go my way or she was different, et cetera.
It never goes exactly how you plan, ever. And it generally works out for better than what you had planned. That's my experience, at least.
Yeah, 100%.
Now, Rich, with all of this, you know, attention that you got and media attention and accolades and things like that, many, many people would crumble under the pressure of the ego of like, you're the best, you're awesome, you're great, look what you've done. And I love, 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 love. How did you handle that kind of attention, which I'm assuming you didn't get as a corporate lawyer? It was a new thing for you. How did you handle that? You know, as a recovering addict and in your recovery, I mean, I can't believe that kind of attention is good for recovery as a general statement. I might be wrong, but please tell me what do you think?
Yeah, I mean, well, the first thing I would say is I still suffer on some level from imposter syndrome. Like, I just can't even believe that I'm here, and I'm still waiting for them to like take my microphone away. Or
same here, my friend. Same here.
So, and also, you know, I'd never won a big race, and then when I got a book deal, it was like, oh, I get to write this book. Like, but I'm not a world champion, and I'm not like. Yeah, I did some interesting things, but there's a lot of people out there who are a lot better at this stuff than I am. Like, why am I being tapped to write a book? You know, I'm constantly, you know, reminded that I've been given this privileged opportunity to do certain things that most people, you know, never get in their lifetimes. And I think that keeps me humble and grounded. And, you know, then the book came out. It wasn't a New York Times bestseller. It's not like I have all the, you know, it did fine and it continues to sell and that's great. And people enjoy the book. Then I started the podcast and, you know, was starving for years and years and years and almost lost our house and, you know, had cars repossessed. Like, I've been humbled so much so that by the time I actually started to get, you know, meaningful success, I was a much more grounded, sober person and capable of, you know, handling the emotional experience of the attention. But it's still like, now I get a lot of attention and I really do have to endeavor to keep my ego on in check and remember, like, this is not like, it's not about you, dude. Like, you didn't do this. Like, for some reason you're in this position where you get to do this cool thing, but you are, you know, a servant to a message and it's not about your ego and your personality. But you know, I get caught up in it just like anybody would. And I have to, you know, bring myself back down to earth and all of that. But, you know, it happening, you know, I'm 55 now. And like everything that I'm doing is just kind of kicking into high gear now. And because I'm an older person and I've had a lot of experiences and I've been humbled so many times, I just think I'm able to process it in a healthier way than certainly that I would have been able to in my 20s and 30s.
Oh my God. Could you imagine in your 20s or 30s? Jesus. I had a hell of an experience when in my 20s where I almost made a $20 million movie for the mafia and I was flown out to LA and I met all these huge movie stars and all this kind of stuff. And I look back at that and obviously it didn't go through. And I say, thank God I didn't get that. I would have self-destructed. I had no tool set whatsoever to handle any sort of success at that age. I would have destroyed myself. So the universe was like, let's give him a taste. Let's torture him. Let's give him some trauma. And that's going to help him along the way for the rest of his life.
You get what you're capable of handling.
Yeah. And sometimes we all hear those stories of those people who get that when they're not ready. And we've seen in Hollywood, I mean, both you and I worked in the business. So we've seen it. People just destroy themselves. It's not easy. It's the fame and attention and all that stuff. It's fleeting. But when it comes in, it's not an easy thing to handle. You do need to have been humbled a bit. And it's much better to get success in your 40s and 50s than it is in your 20s or 30s.
Second that.
Now, I've been plant-based now for over a decade, and you are an inspiration because you are one of the best known plant-based athletes, because you were doing it, like you said earlier, not a lot of people were talking about it or doing full plant-based athletics before. What part has being plant powered, as you call it, affected you in your life as an athlete? And then, of course, the main question is, where do you get your protein, sir? How do you live?
You're actually going to ask me that?
No, okay. Of course I'm never going to. No. Come on, that's it's ridiculous for you and me, but so many people. That's the first question that comes in. How do you eat? I'm like, oh, I just go out and eat the grass. I don't even have to pay a gardener. I just eat the grass like a cow. That's all I do.
Yeah, it's been, you know, look, it's been an amazing journey. There's no aspect of my life that isn't, you know, impacted positively by this lifestyle. And I'm sure you would agree with it. Mm-hmm. And it's been, you know, an evolution and a kind of growth accelerator for me as much as anything else. It's like I initially, you know, when I had that staircase episode, I was like, I need to make a change. I did like a 7-day juice cleanse, and then I played around with a bunch of different diets, and then thought, well, maybe I'll be a vegetarian. But then that just meant going to Pizza Hut and keeping the pepperoni off the, you know, like right. I tried all the easier, softer ways and was ready to kind of abandon some methodology around healthy eating altogether, and just thought, well, maybe you're just supposed to feel like shit when you're in your 40s. And, you know, I was just turned 40 at the time. And I thought, well, there's one thing I still haven't checked off here, and it sounds horrible, you know, but I can't really say I gave it a go unless I give this a try. And that was, you know, eating 100% plant-based, which was such a foreign concept to me. This is 1998. What was it? What year was it? No, it was, so let's see, 15 years ago, whatever that was.
2000 and something. Yeah, 2007.
Yeah, 2005, 2006. And very quickly, like within 7 to 10 days of eradicating all animal products from my plates and, you know, getting rid of the processed foods as well, I felt better than I'd felt in as long as I could remember. And I just realized, like, wow, there's something about this that is really powerful. I want to understand it better and learn more. And it's just been a process of building on that ever since. And I made a promise to myself back then that if it wasn't working, that I wouldn't be dogmatic about it, and I'd be willing to entertain a different way. But, you know, it served me well for 15 years, and now at 55, I can still go out and, you know, push myself hard. And I'm not training as much as I was when I was doing those rails, because I have other interests and pursuits that I think are more meaningful to me now. But I still get out and, you know, train and crush myself and all of that, and I'm still able to build any muscle mass, and I feel very fit for a 55-year-old, and it's been incredible. But, you know, my point being that at the inception of that journey, I would say that my motivations were you know, fairly, you know, selfish. It was somewhat about vanity. Like, I didn't like how I looked in the mirror. I didn't like feeling like shit. And I wanted to feel good in my body again. And I wanted to be able to, like, take my shirt off at the beach or whatever. And that was about it. But, you know, as I've plotted this course, this lifestyle has opened me up to so much expansion. And my motivations for continuing to pursue the lifestyle are very different these days. Like, for me, it's about living, you know, more sustainably on the planet. And it's about living a life of ahimsa. How do you live a more compassionate life? And the choices that we make every single day, not just what ends up on our plate 3 times a day, but all of our consumer choices have impacts on other people and on the planet. And to the extent that we can be more conscious around those choices, understanding that, you know, we all leave an impact on the earth, and it's not about perfection, but it's about, you know, striving to be better, I think is a really beautiful way to live. And I can tell you when, you know, early on, like the plight of the animals was something that never entered my mind. And now, you know, that's something that I think about and consider quite a bit. Mm-hmm. So, you know, in the context of like the vegan movement, one of the things that kind of irks me is when people who are interested in making shifts in their lifestyle get shamed out of the gate because they're not doing it perfect. Or if you're right. a real vegan, you do it way. And it's like everybody is on their, you know, like journey towards being better. And I'm all about like fanning the flames of positivity and celebrating the small wins, because I know that, you know, I've grown so much in the years that, you know, I've been, you know, trying to get better. And you have to leave, you know, permission and space for people to have their own experiences and come into, you know, their sense of awareness on their own with encouragements.
Now, you talked a little bit about processed foods. Can you know, as being a plant-based guy myself, you could be a very unhealthy vegan. You could very, I mean, to be a vegetarian, you could be, like you said, just go to pizza and just leave the meat off and you're a vegetarian. But being a plant-based vegan or being a vegan, I got caught in the processed food world where there's just like now more, when I started 10 years ago and when you started 15 years ago, there wasn't a lot of options. Like it was a challenge to find other than tofurkey, you know, which is, sorry, tofurkey is horrible. there wasn't a lot of options where today, there is so many plant-based foods and so many processed plant-based options for you. What is your take on these whole processed foods? How can we kind of liberate ourselves a bit more from the processed foods so it's better for our health?
Yeah. You know, you said like, oh, you know, 10, 15 years ago, it was so much harder, but I like to flip that argument and say it's actually kind of harder now than it was then because, you know, these companies have figured out how to make meat and dairy analogs with plant-based ingredients that actually taste good. You know, that it used to be the stuff tasted terrible, so you wouldn't want it anyway. Right. And the truth of the matter is that the preponderance of those products are made with a lot of, you know, additives and preservatives and sugar and saturated fat and all these things that we're trying to, you know, get rid of in our diet. So there's a huge difference between being vegan and being plant-based and being whole food plant-based. So the rule of thumb is eat plant-based foods as close to their natural state as possible and try to eschew or avoid those processed foods. And, you know, look, do you want to have like, a plant-based, you know, one of those burger patties every once in a while? That's fine, but it shouldn't be the building block upon which you're building your diet. So I think it is harder now because you can delude yourself like, well, it's vegan, so it's fine. And then you realize like all you're eating is Oreos and like Beyond Burgers all day long. Like it's not a healthy way to live. Right. At the same time, these things are not black and white or binary because I think it's a win for the planet. The more of these, you know, food products and meat and dairy analogs are, you know, widely adopted at the fast food restaurants, et cetera, because, you know, truly we have to move away from animal agriculture, factory farming. It's killing the planet. It's obviously, you know, ending the lives of, you know, it's creating unbelievable suffering for billions of animals every single year. And, you know, it's a terrible way to produce food for humanity. And once you go plant-based and you actually feel better and realize that, oh, I feel better. It's better for the planet. It's better for the animals. Like all the boxes are checked. Like, why would I go back? And if I can thrive doing this, like, why are these systems in place that are so damaging? Like, we need to elevate our consciousness and find real solutions to solving these problems. And I think, you know, companies like Beyond Meat and Impossible and Just and the like are really in service to a better planet because they are creating food products that people enjoy, that they like, that don't involve animal suffering or the downstream environmental implications that animal agriculture causes. But that doesn't mean that, you know, so like health is a different function, right? Well, if that's, you know, you got to be a little bit more aware about that kind of stuff. But I think we're at the beginning of this journey, and some of these are now understanding like, oh, we can't just make it taste good. Actually, people do care about like how healthy, you know, coming along now that are doing both. And I'd like to see more of that. So I think it's really exciting in the food space. Mm-hmm. And there's so much innovation going on, not just in the United States, but all over the world. You know, Israel is like, you know, ground zero for a lot of interesting things in food innovation right now. And I think that we're in a good place to really solve some of these existential crises that we face as a, you know, global society.
Now, Rich, I'm going to ask you a few questions I ask all of my guests. What is your definition of living a good life?
I think living a good life is when your actions and your values are in sync, when you feel fully integrated and expressed in your true authentic self, and when you have choices about how to commandeer your time. Like, I think, you know, living a good life involves being conscious of and having domain over where you invest your attention and your energy. I think it's often overlooked. Like, we don't value time as much as we should, but that's the real, unrenewable currency that we all have. So for me, it's about, constant growth, being devoted to growth, and always trying to narrow that gap between, the person that I aspire to be and the person that I am today.
What is your mission in this life?
Improve the lives and raise the consciousness in a meaningful, very meaningful way for as many people as I possibly can. So it's less about the number of people, and it's more about the substantive impact that I can have on the trajectory of people's lives.
And what is the ultimate purpose of life?
To grow and to share freely with others what you've learned along the way. So growth and service.
Fantastic answer, sir. And Rich, where can people find out more about you, your books, your products, and things that you are doing for the world?
Yeah, I mean, you can find everything out about me at richroll.com. The podcast is the Rich Roll Podcast. You can find it on YouTube or on your favorite podcast player. My memoir is called Finding Ultra. And then we have some cookbooks if you're interested in the plant-based lifestyle, The Plantpower Way and The Plantpower Way Italia. So you can find those on my website or also on Amazon. And then we have two volumes of a book called Voicing Change, which is kind of a coffee table version of the podcast with beautiful photography, excerpts from some of my favorite conversations, essays. It's pretty cool. And that's a self-published series that we do here.
Rich, it has been an absolute pleasure and honor talking to you, man. You have been an inspiration to so many people around the world, and I hope you continue to do the good work that you're doing and helping people around the world. And thank you on a personal standpoint for inspiring me. I don't think I'll go do ultra, but I feel like I'm gonna work out a little bit more now after talking to you, sir.
Yeah. No, it's cool. Thank you, Alex. I really appreciate you having me on, and right back at you. I think the more people that are kind of doing the thing that we do, the world is a better place. I think conversations do matter. And the fact that, you've built an audience and I have an audience tells me that there is a thirst and there is a hunger for, meaningful exchanges in our clickbait, kind of soundbite world, and that gives me hope. So more power to you, and thank you for letting me share today.
Appreciate you, my friend. Thanks for watching. Click on one of the videos below to continue your journey, and don't forget to subscribe.